get through this, but we do. Be easy. You came to Vegas, and then here in your last interview, you liked your last interview and came to Vegas. Is Vegas the right place for you to be?
As of right now, yeah, I feel like it's the best available place for me to be, but we'll see how I feel this fight. I feel like my last training camp in Vegas, I look sharp, I look good, I feel it's totally calm, and I'm comfortable with myself.
It's, I was commenting to Wally, it's, you guys seem relaxed, you guys seem like you're in a good place, it seems like the energy's good. The team is smaller than when I met you guys in Colorado. Is it better that it's a smaller group? Is that making it so you guys have that good feeling? You guys have that good feeling?
Not at the end of the day, I realize I keep like family around me, people that's close with me around me. So whether it's smaller, bigger, whoever around me is only going to be people that I genuinely feel for, I genuinely care about, or something like that. So at the end of the day, whether it's smaller, bigger, I mean, either way is going to be the same.
I'm wondering, some of Wally, you were talking about, how you're chasing all these titles. Is motivation for you simply in getting titles from people and building your greatness? Do you pull motivation from other places? Do you pull motivation from people?
Yeah, most definitely. I feel like when I see Terrence Crawford and what he done with his career, just being around Floyd Mayweather and get to see what he did throughout all these years with boxing and going back and watching his fights and seeing things that they would say about him, just to see where he at now, it's like, it motivated me. It made me want to be more than what he was when he was boxing. But more than what Bud is doing now. So, yeah, like I said, the people around me, I kind of see and I kind of pick up on certain things. I decide like what I want to see as an example, and I decide what I want to see as an example, and I make a choice for my life. So.
Are you still learning kind of like how to do that and what it is you like around you, or do you feel like you know what it is you like and you want that around you?
Yeah, I like I said, I like people to be motivated around me. Like, you know, being around me, you got to be motivated, you got to be able to get up and work, and if you want to be something, do something with yourself, so it rubs off, so at the end of the day, somebody who wants greatness, it's going to rub off on me too, because I want greatness too. So, and then it's all positive.
Does training ever get mundane? Are you able to keep that mentality of these people motivating me? Does it get kind of boring? I mean, like you're doing the same thing over and over again. Sometimes I talk to boxers, sometimes later in their career, it gets tired for them. Like, they're doing the same thing over and over again. Have you experienced that at all? Are you able to stay focused on what it is that you want and stay motivated?
Hey, tell them I did turn it up. That's New York, man. How about that?
Does training ever get boring to you? Does the monotony of the same damn thing over and over again? Or are you able to stay motivated with what you want?
Training can sometimes get boring. I mean, like you said, same thing over and over. But you do different things to mix it up and switch it up. And at the end of the day, you chasing something greater than the training right now. So at the end of the day, that's what you got to do to become one of the best. I'm telling myself, all I see is greatness. Tell them about to get out.
It's cool. He said.
Is it important for Pop Pop to be around?
For sure. I feel like my grandfather, the person who got me to where I'm at, he started me. Even when I was a kid, I felt like I wanted to try different things, different sports. He just showed me that boxing was the sport for me, and he kind of got me to where I'm at now. So it's definitely important.
I'm curious, kind of talking about how your relationship has evolved over the years, because once upon a time you were a teenager, you met a 14-year-old kid. Tell me a story. Your 14-year-old kid went to Ukraine. At that time, you're listening to him. You're always listening to him, whatever he says. At this point in your career, you're your own man. You're blazing your own trail. How has your relationship with him evolved, and how has that kind of give and take now that you're able to call your own shots?
I mean, I feel like it's the same thing. Like, it didn't change at the end of the day. I realized what got me here is listening to him. When I was a kid, I listened to him, and I became champion and won all that stuff. So right now, I'm switching the thing up. One thing he always said to me, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So if it's not broke, why should I fix it? I think that anything that he's saying must be right. It worked.
Nobody has your respect, nobody has your ear like Wally does.
Yeah.
Is that accurate, or is there anybody else out there that you kind of give that respect to, or is Wally on a level on his own?
He on a level on his own. He like the OG. Like he's somebody that I gotta I gotta listen to. And he want the best for me. He gonna say whatever it is that he believes is the best for me, whether he's right or wrong. At the end of the day, I'm gonna hear him out and listen and always take what he got to say into consideration.
Is there anything that he's ever said to you that's particularly stuck with you, advice, whatever it is that you kind of keep with you that always rings in your head?
Yeah, as a fighter, there's one thing he always said to me that always stuck with me. He said, hit me one time, shame on you. Hit you two times with the same one, shame on me. Hit you three times, damn, you stupid. So I always realize, like, when I'm in the ring, if somebody hit me with a straight left hand one time, I'm like, okay, you got that off. Hit me with it again, okay, you got that off. If I get hit with it a third time, I'm done. At the end of the day, because I couldn't take away the punch that he just hit me with three times and I knew it was coming. So it took me a long way in the ring. It taught me how to adjust. That's what you call it, like adjustments. And from there on, I adjusted. Every fight, if I see something that's working for somebody, I try to take it away.
For all the things that you do in the ring that you praise for and you're good at, is adjusting to your opponent the most valuable thing that you are able to consistently do in your matches?
Yes. Adjusting to my opponent is the best thing. In boxing, to me, I feel like Floyd Mayweather does it, Andre Ward does it, Terrence Crawford does it. Sugar Ray Leonard back in the day when he was losing to Tommy Hearns, he adjusted. When he fought Roberto Duran the first time, he came back the second time, he adjusted. At the end of the day, the greats make adjustments, so at the end of the day, I feel like that's my best attribute, and I gotta keep capitalizing off of that.
Coming back to the press conference in Atlanta last week, you came in, you started talking to him immediately. I mean, you guys faced off, and you didn't stop until you guys broke. Was that kind of always the plan coming in, that you wanted to run your mouth at him and just kind of see how he reacted, or did that just kind of come in the moment organically?
I mean, I feel like he a little soft at the end of the day, so anything I say to him, you can tell, like, it's getting to him. He try to play it off and try to play quiet, but I know deep down inside it's getting to him. It makes him so angry, it makes him mad, and I enjoy it.
When you see that in an opponent, if you talk to him, you see that